Brothers and sisters, well wishers, those of us who are sympathizing and expressing our condolences to the family of the bereaved, I just want to welcome all of us who are here this afternoon. And before we go into the main aspect of the program for this evening, there are three songs that we are going to sing, at least three of them. And we're going to make way for the platform personnel and the pallbearers as they will bring the casket in. But those of us who are here, we would like to ask for the presence of God to be with us as we begin this funeral service. Remain seated as we bow our heads for prayer. Eternal Father, God of love, we thank you for the comforting presence of the Holy Spirit. We thank you for the presence of friends and well-wishers who are here to sympathize with the bereaving families. We pray at this time that you will be near, very close to us in this mourning and grieving period. And may as we sing songs, may the songs be meaningful and uplifting. Bless the proceedings for today, we pray. And may your name be glorified even in this funeral service, we ask in Jesus' name. Our leaflets have all the songs that we will sing this afternoon. The first one for the song service is "My Faith Looks Up to Thee, Thou Lamb of Calvary, Savior Divine."
My faith looks up to thee, thou Lamb of Calvary, Savior divine. Now hear me while I pray, take all my guilt away. From this day, be holy, thine. May thy rich grace impart strength to my fainting heart, my fear inspired. As thou hast died for me, oh, may my love today pure, warm, and changeless be, a living fire. Why life dark mist I tread, and grief around me spread, be thou my guide, be darkness turn to day, wipe sorrow's tears away, no let me ever stray from thee aside. When in life's trance and dreams, when death's cold sudden stream shall o'er me roll, blessed Savior, then in love fear and distrust remove, obey me safe above all ransomed soul.
Wonderful. The third verse is worth looking at the lyrics of this verse. It says, while life's dark maze I tread and griefs around me spread, be thou my guide. Bid darkness turn to day, wipe sorrow's tears away, nor let me ever stray from thee, from thy side. Wonderful lyrics there for us to ponder upon. I need thee every hour, most gracious Lord. The next hymn, the next page.
I need thee every hour, most gracious Lord. No tender voice like thine can peace afford. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee. I need thee every hour. I need thee every hour. Stay thou nearby. Temptation lose the power when thou art nigh. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee. I need thee every hour. Enjoy your pain. Enjoy your pain. Come quickly and abide, all life is vain. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior, I come to Thee. I need Thee every hour. Teach me Thy will and Thy rich promises in me fulfill. I need Thee, oh, I need Thee. Every, oh, I need Thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to Thee. The last stanza. I need Thee every hour, most holy one. Oh, make me Thine indeed, Thou blessed Son. I need Thee, oh, I need Thee. My Savior, I come to Thee.
Oh yes, ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, we need Jesus more than ever before. Every hour, every moment, every day, every week, every month, every year, we need Jesus. We can't survive a day without Him. And the last song for the song service is the one immediately following I Need Thee Every Hour. Great is Thy faithfulness, O Lord my Father. There is no shadow of turning with Thee.
Great is Thy faithfulness, O God my Father. There is no shadow of turning with Thee. Thou changest not, Thy compassion they fail not. As Thou hast been, Thou forever wilt be.
Great is Thy faithfulness.
Great is Thy faithfulness. Great is Thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed I and have provided. Great is Thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and the stars in their courses above, join with all nature in mourning for weakness. To Thy great faithfulness, mercy and love. Great is Thy faithfulness. Great is Thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, no mercies I see. All I have needed, Thy hand have provided. Great is Thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Last stanza. Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth. Thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, I have provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto thee.
Very beautiful hymn, very appropriate and pertinent. Let me just find out if the officiating ministers are present and ready to go. Excuse. We'd like for the pallbearers to take your positions as the platform, the ministers who are officiating, take their respective places. Pallbearers, please. And while we wait for that to happen, the next hymn that we are going to sing will be the processional hymn. Let every lamp be burning bright. The darkest hour is nearing. The darkest hour of earth's long night before the Lord's appearing. Shall we all stand?
Let every lamp be burning bright. The darkest hour is nearing. The darkest hour of earth's long night before the Lord's appearing. Then trim your lamps, my brethren dear, then trim your lamps with godly fear. The Master's coming draweth near. Let every lamp be burning. Though thousands calmly slumber on, the last great message burning will rest solely in faith upon his promise of returning. Then trim your lamps, my brethren dear, then trim your lamps with godly fear. The Master's coming draweth near. Let every lamp be burning. His word a lamp, his truth a guide. We cannot be mistaken. Though dangers rise on every side, we shall not be forsaken. Then trim your lamps, my brethren dear. Then trim your lamps with godly fear. The Master's coming draweth near. Let every lamp be burning. Then let good works with faith appear to help the world around us. Obedience brings the blessing, yeah, when faith has firmly bound us. Then trim your lamps, my brethren, yeah. Then trim your lamps with godly fear. The Master's coming draweth near. Let every lamp be burning.
Thank you very much.
Good afternoon to everyone. This afternoon, I want to welcome each and every one of us in the presence of God this afternoon. I want to welcome every family that have made it possible to be here this afternoon as we celebrate the life of Tyrone Hippolyte. I would also like to welcome Tyrone's co-workers who work with him, his family's friends, far and near. Welcome one, welcome all, as we celebrate the life of Tyrone Hippolyte. So welcome one, welcome all, as we celebrate his life. We shall bow our heads as I kneel, as we do the opening prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, indeed, this afternoon we want to exalt your name because your name is higher than all name under the face of the earth. And even as we have come in a sacred time like this, we know that you have always promised us that even when we go through such a time, that your Holy Spirit is ever near to comfort us. So as we go through this proceeding this afternoon, I pray that you will strengthen the family, do what we cannot do for ourselves, and when you will burst the clouds in glory, find each and every one of us faithful until we meet on the sea of glass. Bless the proceedings here, that everything that will be said and done here this afternoon will be to the glory of your name. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.
Let me say good afternoon to everybody, and we are indeed grateful that you have turned up to pay your last respect to our deceased brother. At least you have come at the right time when the family would do well with your support. We just want to make mention here that our program is set, and the intended persons that has to pay the various part, we would appreciate if you can take a note as to where you come, and at the appropriate time you will do what you have to do. Actually, we want to apologize always for the situation as it is when your loved ones has passed and you cannot give them a decent burial. The distancing, as is very obvious, is something that the state authority is saying you need to observe it. And so I notice we have persons sitting very close to each other. We would want to say to you, if for reasons that I'm not aware of, you are sitting by somebody who doesn't belong to the same, under the same roof or the same household, we would appreciate if you can consider the social distance. There's still access to consider this. And of course, well, while in some instances folks want to argue, but I'm saying that we are struggling with trying to ensure that we do our best with our dead, but the time will come when we would not even be around to bury them. So welcome again. And those of you who have turned up, we say welcome. But more so, we want to extend on behalf of the pastor of the church in Mount Olive, the church board members, and the Adventist church in Grand Rivière, we say Mount Olive, we want to extend our deepest condolences to the immediate family. And we trust that in your moment of grief, God is going to see you through. We do acknowledge as well, we have friends from overseas, family members from overseas, from whatever part of the world that you are viewing, we extend our condolences as well. Ladies and gentlemen, it's a strange time we have come to. The philosopher would say, it's unprecedented in nature. But nonetheless, God knows, he understands. Those of you who mourn today, he will comfort you. He will be there with you in your moment of grief. God bless you as the program continues unannounced. Thank you. And you notice, ladies and gentlemen, the kind of juggling there we have to do with the mics. I think we had some sanitizing. Give me another mic.
Good afternoon, everyone. This is a memorial tribute on behalf of Amelia Actel. I am not sure how to do this. Describe someone so special in plain old words. And how can I possibly sum up the feelings and memories I have for Tyron in one tribute? It's almost impossible. I've received so many messages since Tyron's passing, and I've heard from many people from many places saying, there are no words. Well, there are. There are words. There are words of happiness about the treasured time we all had with Tyron, albeit to brief. There are words of beauty to describe his individuality and what he represented. There are words of sorrow to try and communicate what I am feeling now he has left us. But maybe most of all, there are words of strength, of hope, of power, of resilience, of tender love. Words that can bring us all together to cross these choppy waters and come out the other side better for it. For me, Tatai, as I affectionately called him, was a refreshing soul full of love and determination. He was a great listener with time for friends from all walks of life. He was as selfless as he was determined and left his mark on so many people. Tyron Hippolyte was a gift to those who knew him. He was a gentle, God-fearing soul. As a child, he had an astounding and selfless love for people, especially persons in need. He tended to gravitate towards such persons and never hesitated to help. He was respectful to others. Although he was quiet, he had a good sense of humor and enjoyed a good time with his friends and workmates. Those of us who knew him would agree that indeed he was unique. Most importantly, Tyron believed in God wholeheartedly and believed in prayer just as much. As a young man growing up, I clearly remember him waking on a morning, meditating and praying. I also remember him giving my sister Dean, who was a child then, her first Bible, which to this day she still cherishes. My brother loved God, loved life, and genuinely loved people and animals. He strongly disliked seeing children or animals being ill-treated. Throughout his childhood and adult life, he had several pets and farm animals. He could never understand how someone would take so much time to care for and rear an animal, then butcher and eat that very animal which was reared and cared for. He found that to be inhumane. Tyron disliked persons gossiping about each other. On many occasions, when privy to gossip, he would say, "Tell the person how you feel. Don't speak ill of the individual." He always maintained that persons needed to be forgiven. He encouraged that we stopped harboring dislike and hatred in our hearts. He would often say, "This is not God's way. You forgive, you may or may not forget, however, move on, because we are all brothers and sisters in Christ." Tyron touched people in different ways. I remember him caring for his fiancée and her children, and never once complained. I also remember his fiancée being terminally ill and him caring for her throughout her illness. Tyron kept on caring for her children even after her passing, and the youngest, Tori, stayed with him. He ensured she got everything as a young child until she left secondary school. I remember him telling me, "As long as she finishes school, it's okay if he dies." Today, Tori has migrated and is studying to be a registered nurse. He was so proud of her accomplishment. Most men would have run in such a situation, but Tyron didn't. Very few persons have a heart like this man. I strongly believe if this world had more Tyron Hippolytes, the world would surely be a better place. Tyron would have his last $100, and if someone came with an issue, he would give it up silently without anyone ever knowing. That man would stay without and help. When he helped in confidence. And man, can that guy keep a secret? If you confided in him, it stayed right there, never to be uttered. Several times I have tried to remember what bad things he has done. However, each time I turn up with nothing. I have seldom thought and said to myself, "So good Tyron, good like that." Believe it or not, he was. Don't get me wrong, no one is perfect. But that guy was a bon-ish, like the older persons tend to say. On numerous occasions, I have heard his mother say just that, "Tyron is a good son." Tyron had an element of stubbornness, however, it was not unto damnation. Tyron made me understand things spiritually and often explained biblical connotations that I was unable to see on my own. Tyron got baptized a year and a half ago. I witnessed him diligently worshiping at night, and he religiously opened and closed Sabbath with worship and prayer together with his team. He worshiped throughout illness. When he began succumbing to the illness and had little energy, he would say he was tired. It bothered him that he could not keep up, especially when it came to worshiping. As Tyrone's illness progressed, he never complained. When asked how he was doing, he was always okay or hanging in there. He tried always to remain cheerful and in good spirit despite his illness. Never complain, but it bothered him greatly that he was unable to do his worship the way he enjoyed. I have gathered that when someone has qualities like Tyrone, one tends to go all out for such an individual. He gave kindness and radiated love. Therefore, kindness was given right back to him. On July 22nd, 2021, Tatai decided he was going to rest. I got frantic and panicked. I wanted him to leave. Indeed, I am selfish. I was not ready, and I'm still not ready to let go. I always pushed him to not give up, but that morning he calls me and said, "Mia, I am dying." I said, "No, you are not dying." I had his mom take the phone, and I asked her if he is dying. She said, "He's not dying, but he's not doing well." I prayed and figured his oxygen level was going down like it sometimes did. But Tatai knew. On our way to the hospital, my sister Sylvie said, "Mia, you need to accept it. You keep pretending like he is not sick. He is tired and wants to rest." I said, "As long as he has breath, I will pray." However, Tyrone had plans. He was tired and he wanted to rest, as he had indicated occasionally, but I never took seriously. He hated the frequent trips to the hospital. On that day, God granted him just the rest he sought. I recently spoke to a church elder whom my sister Sylvie had spoke to Tyrone because he seemed a little down the week he passed. I asked, "How did the conversation go?" He replied, "Your brother is okay spiritually. We prayed and spoke, and I was awed by his faith. The message I'm humbly trying to bring out here is that we all need to have love and affection in our hearts wherever we may go, whether it be at home, work, church, or socially. Let's remember that when Jesus was on earth, he cared for the poor. He administered and preached to those in need. Brothers and sisters, let's love each other. Showing love, being humble, goes a long way. Even those of us who work in the medical field, yes, we have some awesome nurses and doctors, but we also have a lot who don't treat people right. And sad to say, many of these persons profess to be Christians. People treat each other with love, just like Jesus always treats us with love. Help each other, even though those you help may never return that help. But guess what? You will definitely get that love from someone else. Let's be more Christ-like in character. Let's show love and kindness. This world is a messy place, and I don't believe it will change anytime soon. God has assured my family that Tatai is okay. I'm not worried for him spiritually. I know for a fact he has fought the good fight and has kept the faith, that a crown is waiting. I know he is sleeping until Christ returns to take us home. Tyrone claimed the promises found in Revelation 7, verses 13 to 17. "These are they which came out of great tribulation and have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore are they before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple. And he that sitteth on the throne shall dwell among them. They shall hunger no more, neither thirst any more. Neither shall the sun light on them, nor any heat. For the Lamb which is in the midst of the throne shall feed them, and shall lead them unto living fountains of waters. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. Tyran reminded us to keep our lamps trimmed and burning until Christ returns. I am really going to miss Tyran, but his wonderful memory will forever be etched in my heart. My beloved, Tyran, Tatai, Ras, Philman, rest easy until we link up. But I'm not coming yet, my brother. Loved you in life, in death, and beyond, till we meet at Jesus' feet. Amen.
This is a tribute from my sister Bowie Otori Volney. Dad, what can you say about someone who has always been one of the most essential parts of your world? Someone who took you by the hand and helped show you the way. What do you say to someone who stood by you to help you grow? Providing love, strength, and support so you can become the person you are today. There aren't enough words to let him know that he was the best there was, and that I hope I inherited some of his wisdom and strength. My dad was a caring person. He taught me so much amazing things. Tatai came into our lives when we were really young. He raised all of us like we were his biological children. He gave us everything that we needed, and for that we will forever be grateful. He was the most selfless person that we knew. He sacrificed so much for us. Because of that, we now know the definition of a father's love. After losing our mom, my sister was so broken on the inside that he did the one thing she will forever be grateful for. He stayed. He was her safety net every time she needed someone to talk to, or she needed advice or a shoulder to cry on. He would be that person for her. He always made sure she had everything she needed for school, and he wanted her to be very successful. He made her the person that she is today. So please, let's not cry or be sad. Let's celebrate, and let's remember him for the amazing person he was. Let's cherish his memories, because right now, that's all we have left of him. We will always be thankful that he was chosen to be our dad. And wherever life takes us, we will always honor him.
Hello. Good afternoon.
There will be another angel
and I will hold on tight. It's not my place to question. Only God knows why. I'm just jealous of the angels around the throne tonight. Always made my troubles feel so small, and you were always there to catch me when I'd fall. In a world come and go, God just took the only one I know. So I'll hold you as close as I can, longing for the day when I'll see your face again. But until then, God must need another angel around the throne tonight. Your love lives on inside of me, and I will hold on tight. It's not my place to question, only God knows why. I'm just jealous of the angel around the throne tonight, singing hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. I'm just jealous of the angels around the throne tonight.
To come here and do what the Lord wants to do. You can't spread amongst those who are done.
March 18, 1972, witnessed a remarkable event, the birth of a noble male child in the person of Tyrone Hippolyte, born to two young individuals. Tyrone's earlier years began in Balata. As a young child, he was quiet, shy, and loving. He belonged to a huge extended family, which consists of siblings, cousins, both in Balata and Grand Rivière Grozilly. Tyrone enjoyed visiting and spending time with his mom. He loved teasing and playing with his siblings and cousins as any typical young boy. He attended the Carmen René Memorial School and then later transferred to Balata Government School. He loved the beach, animals, football, trucks, and had a passion for anything mechanical. He always respected authority and seldom got in any trouble. Tyrone was employed with Courts for over 20 years, then transitioned to Renwick and Company. Both places of employment deemed Tyrone as an exemplary worker and individual. At Renwick, he made it his duty to arrive early at work and would sit out in the entrance to take his early sun bath, vitamin C as he would call it, and not vitamin D. To this day, many onlookers heading to Castries would cast an eye to the left on approaching Renwick to witness this gentleman. But alas, as he fought pain and dark moments, he could not be given assurance of physical rehabilitation, but was offered the hope of a new life in Christ. This he gladly accepted and ratified on March 27, 2020 at the Castries SDA Church, where his membership was later transferred to the Mount Olives SDA Church in Grand Rivière Grozilly. All this was as a result of the nightly Bible studies with him. He developed a love for song number 595 in the SDA hymnal, Let Every Lamp Be Burning Bright, a song which is married to Revelation 7, 9 to 17, a Bible text he hoped to fulfill in Christ at his return, putting on the white robe of righteousness. Titi butterflied his way into the Savior's arms with no pain, being able to breathe again as he had always wanted. His final words to us intended to comfort us after he was gone. Don't worry, and I don't want y'all to cry. A request which we try to live up to. He was a friend to all, a father to many, a son, a colleague, a brother in the faith, a cousin. A light has gone out, and all we have are the lovely memories. So let us all live with the hope of joining him with the saints in being washed in the blood of the Lamb and in putting on the white robe of righteousness. Amen.
Your way, you always walked a step behind. So I was the one with all the glory, while you were the one with all the strength. A beautiful face without a name. For so long, beautiful smile to hide the pain. Did you ever know that you're my hero? You're everything I wish I could be. I could fly higher than I need. You are the wind beneath my wings. It might have appeared to go unnoticed, but I've got it all here in my heart. You to know, I know the truth, of course I know it, I would be nothing without you. Did you ever know that you're my hero? You're everything I wish I could be. And I could fly higher. the wind beneath my wings. Oh, you're the wind beneath my wings. Oh, you. You are the wind beneath my wings.
Revelation 7, verses 9 to 12. After this, I beheld, and lo, a great multitude, which no man could number, of all nations, and kindreds, and people, and tongues, stood before the throne, and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes, and psalms in their hands, and cried with a loud voice, saying, Salvation to our Lord, which sitteth upon the throne, and unto the Lamb. And all angels stood around the throne, and about the elders, the four beasts, and fell before the throne on their faces, and worshipped God, saying, Amen, blessing, and glory, and wisdom, and thanksgiving, and honor, and power, and might be unto our God, forever and ever. Amen.
I want to make offer a prayer of comfort for the family. And we would want to make a distinction with regards to the audience that is present. We would want the immediate family to stand, and the rest of the congregation, I would ask that you continue seating. So please now, the immediate family, could you just stand as I do the prayer of comfort? All of you, please. And the rest of the audience, you take a prayer of posture as we at this time would have prayer. I lift my eyes to the hills. And from whence cometh my help? My help cometh from the Lord who made the heavens and the earth. Our Father, we thank you that at this time we have gathered here to celebrate one who was very unique. We have discovered, Lord, from the very dawn of human history, humankind have not been accustomed to death and dying. And every time death would show up and its ugly face would be playing in our faces, we are saddened, we moan. But this afternoon, dear Lord, we want to ask that you would visit this spot. See the mourners, those who are broken with regards to the passing of Tyrone. What an awful situation. But as we mourn this afternoon, we mourn with the understanding that his life was one that was well lived. Recognize in time that
Jesus, as a friend of sinners, was calling all to come unto him. And Tyrone did that many years ago. And he was very glad about the experience, one unique, one very encouraging. And this afternoon, dear Lord, we remember those who he has left behind. Grant Heavenly Father, as they mourn, they would do this with the understanding that the scriptures make it very clear that we mourn not as those who does not have no hope, but with your comforting grace, your enabling grace, your strengthening grace. Grant Heavenly Father, as they would from time to time remember his passing and remember how important he was in their lives, we pray, dear Lord, they would remember the very cheerful moments, good ones, ones when there was moment of levity, moments of joy, moments of celebration. And God, they would don't end it there, but pay attention to the fact that Tyrone in his time recognized that Jesus is Lord. And one of these days when he rolled back the heavens like a scroll and right forth that day as Lord, as King of Kings and Lord of Lords, everyone who loved Jesus would be happy and glad that day. So we pray this afternoon, dear Lord, we can see Tyrone again. We can live in his very presence once again. Only as we would do the things he did, allowing Jesus to take control of his life. So we pray this afternoon, dear Lord, not just the immediate family, but we pray for friends and well-wishers who have turned up this afternoon to pay the last respect. May they take, as it were, the words of Scripture to heart. Number your days, that you apply your hearts unto wisdom. This afternoon, one has been appointed to bring words of comfort, words of cheer. We pray that you would anoint him this afternoon. Touch his lip with the life call of the altar and grant every word that come from his lip this afternoon would be comforting, would be cheering. And we can leave here knowing that one of these good days, death will die too. So be with us, we pray you. And Lord, we pray that you would take this service in your care. Bless everyone that is here and hasten that time and day, Lord, when life would have ended on this planet, and that glad morning when you say to the north, giver, give up, and to the south, keep not back, bring my sons from afar and my daughters from the end of the earth. Each one here today would have, who would have made their peace with you, take us to that place that you are now preparing for us. We pray you and we bless you and we thank you in the mighty name of Jesus, and let the people say, amen. Amen. Thank you. Be seated.
Good afternoon, everyone. And let me just take this opportunity to extend condolences to the bereaved family. I know that it's a very, very painful time for you. And while we may attempt to understand the pain that you feel, we can't. Because we're not in the context. But we understand that even if you are feeling the pain now, there is one individual by the name of Jesus who stands by you to comfort you. He stands by you to embrace you. Because the Bible says in Psalm 46 that God is your refuge and your strength. He is a very present help in this time of distress. So I want you to trust him. I want you to hold on to him, depend upon him, because he will surely see you through. The psalmist David again tells us that it's okay to cry in your pain. Crying itself is therapeutic. It's okay to cry because you've lost a loved one. But while you cry, the psalmist David says that crying or weeping will endure for a moment, for a night. Therefore, you should look for joy because joy will come and it will come in the morning. So I pray that you will trust God, depend upon him, and allow him to just have his way in your life as you seek his comfort and his strength. And I want you to know one more thing before I preach this afternoon. He says through the pen of Peter that you can cast all your cares on Jesus because he cares for you. He cares for you and he will take care of your needs. So I trust that God will bless you, family members, friends, relatives, as you mourn the loss of your loved one. And let me just welcome those of you who have come here to render support to the family. I encourage you to continue to pray with and for them because they need our prayer. They need our prayers. So I invite you at this time, you know, to turn your Bibles with me, those of you who have it. Just turn your Bibles with me to the book of Job. Now, those of you who know about Job knows that Job's name is synonymous with pain, with sorrow. But we won't look at Job's sorrow today. I just want you to, you know, just focus on two verses of scripture taken from Job chapter 14. So let's look at Job chapter 14. We'll consider verses 1 and 2. Job chapter 14, verses 1 and 2. And let me just assure you that I won't be long. I just want to provide some words of comfort to the family. And I pray that you will submit yourselves so that God can heal you even as we spend some time in his presence. Job chapter 14, verses 1 and 2, it says, "Man that is born of a woman is of few days and full of trouble." He's what? He's of few days and he is full of trouble. "He cometh forth like a flower and is cut down." Okay. "He cometh forth as a flower and is cut down. He fleeth also as a shadow and continueth not." Before I continue, would like the owner of vehicle registration number NO8449 to just remove your vehicle. You're obstructing traffic. I think Pastor Miller has to leave, so he just wants NO8449 to just remove your vehicle so that he can exit. "Man that is born of a woman is of few days and full of trouble. He cometh forth like a flower and is cut down. He fleeth also as a shadow and continueth not." This short discourse is entitled, "What is Man?" What is man? Let's bow our heads as we pray. Father in heaven, we thank you so much for your goodness towards us. Thank you, dear God, for giving us an opportunity to see your goodness and your mercies even in the midst of death. We pray a special blessing upon every family member, upon everyone who is mourning at this time. And may you be with me, speak to me and through me, so that every heart will be touched in Jesus' wonderful name. Amen. Amen. What is man? You see, the dictionary tells us that man is a human being of either sex. That is man. Another definition is that man is a full-grown individual who is mature, whether male or female. A third definition says that a man is one who has grown to be mature with beard and is of the male sex, man. I want to let you know this afternoon that irrespective of what definition we embrace for man, the Bible says simply that man is dust. Are you listening to me? The Bible says that God created man out of the dust of the ground, breathed into his nostrils, and man became a living soul. It means that man is dust. And the Bible says that because you are dust, you will return to dust. Just follow me now. Just follow me. You know, some of us boast because we have a prestigious job. Some of us boast because you have a fat bank account. Some boast because you are a millionaire. Some boast because you have a prestigious name. However, the Bible says that irrespective of your status in society, you are still dust. And dust will you return. Are you listening to me? Now, where am I going with this? I tell you, I will not be long. We are all dust. Job describes us this way. He says, you cometh forth like a flower, and then you are cut down. So Job likens man to a flower. Isaiah says that man is grass. And if I know grass well, we know that usually grass grows in your yard. And after it has grown for to a particular height, you use a weed eater, you cut it down. So I sometimes pass this morning, come back in the evening, and the tall grass is now cut down. This is man. So the Bible is saying that man is a flower. It appears now and it is cut back down. James says that we are a vapor. It appears now and later it's no more. So why am I saying all of this? I'm saying all of this to let you know that because you are dust, then we need to ensure that we pay attention to what God is saying to us, because we are his dust. And life is not about what you have, but life is more about who you are. This is the point. Because we are all dust. I am dust. You are dust. You are dust. Whether you're a pastor or a priest, a prime minister or a pauper, you may be a farmer or a vagrant, we are all the same dust. Therefore, what's important? What's important is who I am. What's important is who I am in Christ, and how I live my life will define who I am. Now, I've told you all of this to tell you four things, and I will begin now. When I listen to the tributes and the eulogy, and having spoken to the deceased sister, there are certain things that just jumped at me as it relates to the quality of life that we should live as human beings. And I will point out four things, because this is what is important for us as human beings and more so as God's children. The deceased, we are told, was a selfless individual. He was selfless. Why? Because there was nothing too much for him to do for somebody else. Are you listening to me?
How many of us can boast today that we are selfless? You see, we live in a world that is defined by getting rich and getting rich quickly. We live in a world that is defined by get all you can all you get, and then sit on the lid of the can. We live in a world that is punctuated by greed and selfishness. Am I talking truth? But even through the life of one who is lying in this casket, we can learn that selflessness is better than riches. This is why Solomon, the wisest man who ever lived, said that a good name is better. A good name is rather to be chosen, according to the King James Version. A good name is rather to be chosen than great riches, and loving favor rather than silver or gold. It means, therefore, that my character is more important than the money that I have in my pocket. Are you listening to me? Having integrity is better than having a fat bank account. Being honest is better than having a Cadillac in my yard. Are you listening to me? What I'm saying today is that we need to understand that because we are all dust, we have no advantage over each other. God is asking us today to be selfless individuals, because he has given himself through selflessness so that you can be saved today. The Bible makes it clear in Romans chapter 5, verse 8, that God demonstrated his love towards us. Because of his selflessness, he demonstrated his love towards us in that he went to the cross and he died for you and for me. He took the place that belonged to you so that you can receive the place that belongs to him. He took the humiliation that I deserved so that I could receive the glory that he deserves. So the Bible says we need to be selfless. You know, when I listened, I realized that he was a man who was compassionate. You know, he looked out for the poor and the unfortunate in our midst. The Bible says true religion is when you reach out to the poor. Not just coming to church and singing hymns of praise and hymns of adoration, but it's about reaching out to people, loving people, showing that you genuinely care about each other. What is man? Do we love each other? Do we care about each other? Are we concerned about what the other individual eat on a morning? While we throw food, somebody is suffering. So I encourage you, I challenge you to live selflessly. Secondly, he disliked gossip. And I love this one, because the average person is a gossiper. I'm going to say it again. Maybe you did not hear me. And I need you to respond to me this time. If you cannot say amen, say ouch. The average person is a gossiper. Esa pa fue. The average person is a gossiper. So somebody comes to you because they have a particular problem and they need a confidential ear to listen and a confidential mouth to keep it in. But before they utter the final word, then their neighbor has received the news. Am I talking truth? But you see, Tyron, we are told, was different, because he understood the word of God when it says that there are six things that the Lord hates, and it says seven, seven are an abomination unto the Lord. And it says the seventh is he who sows discord among the brethren. Now, sowing discord means that you're carrying tales. And tale bearing is the same as gossiping. Are you listening to me? And mind you, gossiping does not necessarily have to be false news. But it's news that you should keep to yourself. So I often say it's not because, you know, we are not at liberty to say something because it's the truth. We need to be responsible about what we share. We need to be responsible about who we share it with. And we need to ensure that whatever we say is something that draws an individual closer to God. So Tyron hated gossip. And if you hate gossip, you will have a dislike for hatred. Number three, a very important one. He had a very, very forgiving heart. You see, forgiveness brings healing. I'm going to say this again. Forgiveness brings healing. Many of us believe that forgiveness is beneficial only to the person who is being forgiven. But the person who is doing the forgiving, or the person who has been offended, is the individual who gets most out of forgiveness. There's a book called Forgive to Live. And it's available at the Ayatpa bookstore on the Shuse. You could look for it. Forgive to Live. This book teaches you the power and the importance of forgiveness. Because lack of forgiveness creates more problems, even in our physical bodies, more so psychologically. You know, an individual said that, you know, lack of forgiveness is like drinking poison and expecting the other person to die. Are you listening to me? Lack of forgiveness. So it's important that we forgive. You know, when we mess up, we expect God to forgive us. Isn't that the case? The Lord's Prayer says, forgive me my debt as I forgive my debtors. But we do not want to forgive. And yet we expect God to forgive us. And finally, because I promise not to be long, he loved the Lord. He did what? He loved the Lord. You see, Tyron understood that living selflessly down here is not a disadvantage. He understood that even if people may think that I am stupid by being selfless, God will reward me. So you see, the Bible tells us that God is the one who first loved us. And that because he loved us, he went to Calvary. John chapter 3 verse 16, a well-known text, it says, for God so loved the what? Say it with me. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. This is the great love story. For God so loved the greatest lover, the world the greatest possession, that he gave his Son the greatest gift, that whosoever the greatest invitation believes in him the greatest acceptance, will not perish the greatest deliverance, but have eternal life, the greatest assurance. God loves you with an everlasting love. And if you give your life to him today, there can be a reunion on Hallelujah Square on resurrection morning. Why? Because we believe that Tyron, who is lying in that coffin right now, will be resurrected on that faithful morning. We believe that he will be with Jesus because we believe that he died with the Lord. Are you listening to me? And Paul says, if you die in Christ, you will be resurrected in Christ. And this is why Paul says to the brethren in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 verse 13, he says, brethren, and I'm going to say to you family members, friends, He says, I do not want you to be ignorant concerning those who have fallen asleep in Jesus, that you do not sorrow or you do not cry, even like those who have no hope. He says, for if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also who sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. In other words, the Bible tells us that those who sleep in Jesus will be resurrected to meet Jesus when he comes the second time. And in order to sleep in Jesus, you must ensure that you live for Jesus. So then he continues, he says, for I say unto you, that by the word of the Lord, we who are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent those who are fallen asleep to be resurrected by the Lord. Then he says, for the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout. You see, Jesus is soon to come. And when Jesus comes, he's coming to bring rewards to those who have either lived for him or for the enemy. So he is coming to bring rewards, because the Bible tells us clearly that when he comes, he's not coming to see where you are, but it's because your fate is sealed. You are either for him or against him. And this is why he said to the disciples in John, he says, marvel not at this, for the hour is coming when all who are in the grave shall hear his voice. Those who have done good unto the resurrection of life, and those who have done evil unto the resurrection of damnation. So he says, the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. You see, this business is so important for Jesus. Resurrection is so important that he does not leave this task to any angel. But he leaves it and reserves it as a task that he himself must execute, because it's important. So he says, the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them to meet the Lord in the clouds, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Then he ends this chapter by saying, wherefore, brethren, comfort one another with these words. I just came here to remind you that your life on earth is short. Job says, man born of a woman is a few days and full of trouble. There will be difficulties. There will be pain. There will be heartaches. There will be death. We cannot escape death. We cannot escape pain. Nonetheless, we can live a life in Christ, so as to ensure that when Christ comes, this shortened life will be replaced by everlasting life. This world of trouble will be replaced by a world where there will be no more sin, no more death, no more crying, no more decay. This sin-sick world will be replaced by a world where sin will never pop its ugly head again. Jesus is about to come, and he wants you to be ready so that when he comes the second time, you will receive a place in his kingdom. You will receive a place among the saints. You will receive a place among those who will be waiting and longing to be with Jesus. I trust today that those of you who are here have made a determination that come what may, you will live a life in Christ so that you may be resurrected in Christ to be reunited with your loved one. How many of you want to say today, Lord, it is my desire
to give my life to you so that you could teach me how to live and how to prepare for your soon return. If this is your desire, just wave your hands with me wherever you are. Bow your heads as we pray. Father in heaven, we give you thanks and praise, honor and glory for your matchless love. We thank you, dear God, for giving us an opportunity to reflect on the life of your servant, Tyrone Hippolyte. We thank you, dear God, that even in the midst of death, we can see your beauty and your glory. And we can reflect based on the life that he lived. And we can make adjustments in our lives so as to prepare for your soon return. May you anoint every individual this afternoon. May you touch every heart. May you touch every family member. And may, dear God, you seal every decision made this afternoon so that when you come the second time, because we would have submitted our lives to you, you will grant us a place in your heavenly kingdom. We pray with thanksgiving through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. 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 I invite those of you who sign in the registers, the witnesses, to meet me in the vestry, my left, your right, so we may sign the registers. Thank you.
So tell me, Amelia Actil. Yeah. Name is correctly spelled?
Yes.
What is his occupation?
Thank you.
Good afternoon again, and let me extend my own personal sincere condolences to what I would consider to be my extended family. I want to tell them that I have them in my heart and in my prayers. Okay, so I do love you, and I'm certainly looking out for you and doing what I can to ensure that you do have yourself a very peaceful period of mourning. My task here this afternoon is to say thank you to everybody. The word everybody, obviously, whenever it comes to Thanksgiving, is never fulfilled, because you could never say thank you to absolutely everybody who participates in such an incident, in such a situation. People are so involved that you'd miss out on one or two persons. So I want to begin by first saying thank you to everybody whose name will not be called this afternoon. Thank you. Whatever you did, we are truly thankful. Now, I was not the one who put the list of names together. So, again, if you do not hear your name, please, I say thank you on behalf of Tyron Hippolyte. Okay, so we'd like to say thank you first and foremost to his mother, a mother's love, the greatest love. She was there for him throughout the entire period. I went to her home many times and I saw the sorrow in her heart and I saw the pain. Even 1 week before he passed, I went there and I could see. But her love was unending. She loved him until the last breath. So we say thank you to his mother for being such a great mother. Mr. Timothy Alexis, we say thank you to you. Barbara Mack and family, thank you to you. Magdalene Alexis, thank you. Tracy Darcy, thank you very much. Mr. Effridge and his family, thank you very much. Irving Anthony, we say thank you to you as well. A special thanks to his niece, DeAndre LaForce. And I want to just stay for a minute here because he ensured that every errand that Tyron called him to participate in, So she ensured that every errand she went, he wouldn't call on her for a moment, and she would not attend to his need. So thank you very much. Thank you very much. Special thanks to his Courts family, all of those who worked with him at Courts, those who worked with him as well at Renwick and Company. We want to extend the thank you by calling out one or two of his friends' names, his co-workers, those who visited him at the hospital. We say thank you to you. We want to say a special thank you to Mrs. Renwick and all of the wonderful teams that she have at the institution that facilitated his comfort while he worked there. Thank you very much, Mrs. Renrick. His buddy, Al Joseph, we say thank you to him. Yeah, thank you, Al. A lot of help to him. He met a special friend at the hospital in the name of Nisha. Nisha met him at the hospital, befriended him, and of course, showed him love and cared for him throughout. Thank you, Nisha. Thank you, Nisha. Special thanks to those who prayed, those who visited him at the hospital and at his home, and those who did that very frequently as well. We thank you very much. The family would like you to know that the love was well received and well felt. And they would ask you finally to continue praying for the family throughout their time of mourning. And they in turn will pray for you so that this world may be a better place. Once again, on behalf of the entire family and all of our friends, I say thank you and good afternoon.
All right, this part of the service has almost come to an end. I will invite all of you who are here to just stand with me. All right, I will offer the benediction. And afterwards, the choristers will sing the song, "In a Little While, We Are Going Home." This will be our recessional hymn. So I'm asking you to just pause a while after the prayer. Allow those of us on the platform to descend, followed by the pallbearers with the casket. This will be followed by the family members and then other supporters will follow. All right? So just let's bow our heads, close our eyes as we pray. Father in heaven, we thank you so much for your goodness and your mercies towards us. Thank you, dear God, for ministering to us in such an awesome manner and for teaching us lessons that will prepare us to live and reign with you forever. As we leave this place, we pray a special blessing upon each family member. May the God you guide them, direct them, strengthen them, and embrace them. May they stick together as a well-knit family. May they support each other and love each other. And may by your grace, you bring healing and comfort to them and bring it speedily. Bless us as we're about to leave this place. And as we go to the final resting place, I ask that you will go before us to prepare the way. And may your name be praised, honored, glorified. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen. So the interment will take place at the Shock Cemetery. So please remain standing as we sing the recessional hymn and we make our exit.
Song. Let us sing a song that will cheer us by the way.
Let us sing a song that will cheer us by the way. In a little while we're going home. For the night will end in the everlasting day. In a little while we'll go in home. In a little while, in a little while, we shall cross the billows foam. We shall meet at last where the stormy winds are past. In a little while we'll go in home. We will do the work that our hands may find to do. In a little while we'll go in home. and the grace of God will our daily strength renew. In a little while we'll go in home. In a little while, in a little while, we shall cross the beam, Lord's foam. We shall meet at last when the stormy winds are past. In a little while we'll go in home. There's a rest beyond, there's relief from every care. In a little while we'll go in home, and no tears shall fall in that city bright and fair. In a little while we'll go in home.